Hello, everybody in YouTube land. It's Brewski.
And Patty.
And Jeremy.
And we're here for another lovely episode of the Savage Brewski podcast. Today, we are going to be talking about game mechanics. We are going to be talking about the rules, the little nitty-gritty things that we absolutely love in games that made them stand out, made the game exceptional, made so much sense. You just absolutely took a liking to them and made Chuck Norris play Warhammer.
Yeah, exactly. The rules that got you into the game, or rules that are in a game that you wish could be better, but that one mechanic just keeps you sucked in.
Yeah, alrighty. So we've each chosen two or three rules, and we're going to see how much we can do time-wise here. We're going to, you know, roughly go for about an hour on this one, but we're going to go around. We're just going to sort of round table. You know, the person that researched the rule, looked into the rule, is mentioning the rule, is going to go over all that, and we'll have a little bit of discussion tear up and then move on. So, Jer, why don't you go first, my man? Pick a rule.
All right. So I think I'll go ahead and start with the Mordheim rules for the campaigns. And yes, the reason I think the Mordheim campaign rules made this game so great, and this game hasn't been supported officially by Games Workshop since 2001-2003 time frame, and it still has a ginormous huge backing and followers because of the campaign system. Mm-hmm. I've seen few and far between games that give you this level of a campaign in a miniature setting. So I like to think of Mordheim like you're doing almost like a D&D game. It's like that level of customizability for your group between games. There's leveling, there's permanent injuries. I can play six games of my warband and get them super leveled up, and then fight against your brand new warband, and you won't be at any more of a disadvantage because you'll end up actually getting more experience and more gold or warp stone just by facing a force that's so much larger or so much more experienced from you. And especially if you win that game, and the play styles are all, it's not always a straight up fight. There's objectives, and if you can pull off the objectives better than the other warband, then you can easily beat a warband that is a higher rank than you. I have yet to find another game that does it nearly as well. There are games that try. Frostgrave does similar stuff, but you can only level your wizard, really. It's a lot of the solo games like Rangers of Shadowdeep and Five Parsecs, Five Leagues, they do something similar, but on a smaller level. You don't get the same amount of, there's not as much meat. The meat of the Mordheim campaign just is delicious, and everything I want pretty much for every game. And if I was to officially make a game that I want to sell, I would want to port over a lot of the Mordheim campaign into that campaign system.
Now, shameless self-promotion. I mean, the campaign rules are super light in Mutants, but I also super enjoy campaign systems, and that is a really easy one to work into, like, small amount of time. Jeremy can attest to this, but Mutants, all of the campaign leveling up and buying stuff can be done within 2 minutes for both players afterwards. But Savage, you were saying something?
I was going to say, like, in a little more detail, what about the campaign system? Is it just the fact that it carries so much detail, or is it how one game will translate into the next? Like, can you elaborate on that at all?
So, yeah, it is a combination of the two. So, yes, there's just so much detail in here. They've got different levels of characters. You got your heroes, and then you got your henchmen, and they each have their own leveling system. So you're not, even your henchmen can end up becoming heroes eventually, just depending on how much time and effort they're put in. And then the fact that, like I said, I can take a warband that I haven't touched in 6 years and go to and get a game in with this warband and still be super competitive against somebody else. Even if,
meanwhile, you're not like just raffle stomping all over some guy who's just learning how to play.
Well, there, unfortunately, there are some warbands out there that are broken and they can get super overpowered. Shooting can be a problem in the game if you're playing on a table that doesn't have a ton of terrain. There are, like, obviously elves that are super snipers that can make the game not fun. But yes, it's the leveling system in it. It's so much like an RPG that, like, I guess when I first got into Mordheim, it just scratched that RPG itch that I wasn't getting from being in an RPG group anymore, that I was getting to level up this warband and they were like their own character. So for you that are into video games, it's basically playing Baldur's Gate or Icewind Dale, but on a miniature game level.
Cool. And yeah, it's kind of weird. You're right about the longevity of the game. I keep seeing guys making boards. Geek Gaming Scenics, his last video was a Mordheim board.
Mm-hmm.
MS Paints did a really cool one that was actually somewhat Cthulhu themed. He basically based it on Dunwich Horror. So it was like, it had piers and docks and that real, you know, old dilapidated sort of town feel to it. Very, very cool stuff.
Yeah, I've seen some really cool Mordheim boards. And frankly, go ahead and flame me in the comments. I've never played Mordheim. I've always wanted to, but I think the last time that War God and I were hanging out, we ended up playing campaign games for Dead Zone and Frostgrave. And that's probably, do you have any of the hard copy books for...
Unfortunately, the hard copy book I had got left in El Paso with Jeremiah. We joint purchased it, and he kept it because he liked it. And I figured I'd be able to. I had a digital one already because Games Workshop actually allowed digital downloads of all their periphery games for a while back in 2006, 7, 8 timeframe. And yeah. So that's when I downloaded it. And then there's an awesome website out there called the Brohammer, I believe, where you can just download pretty much everything that's ever came out for the game, as well as a ton of fan stuff that's been added in.
Nice.
Yeah, I'll have to check that out. Mordheim was definitely one of those games that I always heard so much about, and I think the first campaign game that I ever really saw, I think Mark II War Machine, and War Machine will come back up later, but Mark II War Machine, the core rule book towards the back had a very light campaign system where you could build bonds with war beasts. And I was like, oh, that's awesome. It's like Dungeons and Dragons. Only in having ever played at that point, Magic the Gathering, Dungeons and Dragons, and then War Machine. And then seeing that and being like, oh, that's way cool.
Oh yeah.
One of my favorite YouTubers that does Mordheim is Devs and Dice. I believe he's from Sweden. And he builds beautiful tables, and he has tons of terrain boards. And he did these cool tiles to make his table different levels. So like the ground level is not always the same. You could have a building on top of a embankment that's built up out of stone, and then he has buildings that go across the road as well. And he does billboards with all these wanted signs and stuff. And I believe he even did one where there's this big, huge warp stone that's crashed into the middle of the table. He does a lot of cool stuff. It's really, really, really beautiful board. So yes, Eric's Hobby Workshop also does some really nice stuff for it. So, but Devs and Dice and Eric's Hobbies Workshop, I think, are the two that I've really watched to get ideas for Mordheim type terrain.
Good stuff.
Eric does have some pretty cool and pretty slapping terrain. So yeah, that's a good channel to check out. I'm probably just going to start shouting those guys out. All right.
Nice.
Nice. Yeah, I don't know. Terrain is just a thing. It's an ever-present part of almost every game. It's just awesome. So
some games do handle it better than others. And man, when you see those boards, like he was saying, with the different elevations, and you got some that are like two stories up and some that are like crawling around in the sewers below, blocking all that line of sight. It just makes for a really interesting game when you, like, you know, when you take a squat to look at the table from eye level.
Yep.
That's one of my favorite parts of wargaming.
Yeah, you know, the 3-foot rule notwithstanding, you actually get in there and be like, oh my God, is that a 3-eyed fish? Like, yeah.
I've actually always dreamed of having a board for fantasy type use. It's a city. It'll be a permanent board cityscape where there's an actual sewer built into the board that you can play in the sewer, and then as well as you can play outside the sewer on top of the board without being able to like lift the board up. I kind of with a couple of different ideas of how to do it, but and I found lots of files that print out sewers, STL files. It's just some really interesting ideas I've had, and we'll see if any of them ever pan out.
I got a video for you. I'll send that over.
Well, hold on now. Don't just send it over. Share it with the audience.
I will share. This is okay. This is at least going to handle the top part. Again, Geek Gaming Scenics literally use textured wallpaper and actually made a city board. It wasn't for Mordheim specifically, but it was for your medieval fantasy type thing in a city. And you could easily mod that and give it, you know, tiers and give it a sewer underneath. You could actually give it, you know.
I think I remember seeing that video where he used the wallpaper to be his what do you call it? The cobblestone.
Yep.
I think it was one of the last videos I caught before he stopped making videos.
That's an old one.
I'm just saying it's one of the last ones I caught.
Yeah.
I don't watch everybody's videos. There's so many people I'm subscribed to on YouTube. I have to pick and choose my battles. I only have so many hours a day.
Alrighty. Well, I'm not going to tease you on that one. I'll find it for you and send it over, and I'll throw that in the description as well. There's going to be a lot of random stuff in description this week, folks. Just deal with it.
Oh yeah, more stuff to listen to while you continue your daily grind.
Yes. All right. Well, good. So good start, Jer. Patty, you're up.
Yeah. So there's going to be a theme to my three responses. I picked up a couple. One of the things that I really like about tabletop gaming is when there's some way to kind of skew the dice, because we all have those days where, man, you're just rolling like shh. Trying to watch my mouth this episode, but anyway, I'm gonna start off with the game that War God shared with me, which is Dead Zone. It was one of those games where I was checking it out. I wasn't super thrilled with the models at first, and it's probably because I saw like the Enforcers and the GCPS, and I was like, oh, you can just get Imperial Guard and the Space Marines. But then I really got enamored with it when he showed me, and then ended up getting me a nameless box to play with, and it's one of my evolutions in gaming, I guess you could say, like going from Dungeons and Dragons to like War Machine. And I remember like what a big change and chapter that is for me in my life. But then Dead Zone, it's still probably my favorite game and a huge inspiration for Mutants. But anyway, the rule that I really liked was Exploding Eight. So out of the skirmishes on the Forsaken rule book, the Dead Zone third edition rule book, on page 7, for example, fight test, rain test, survive test, a mechanism called Exploding Eights is used. And it's specific here that there is a exclamation mark after the eights. I think both of you guys know that I love including exclamation marks into the title of my games and using it, not using it as a punctuation, but using it as a term.
Yep.
And that's how it's used in here. So the I in IST after Exploding Eight is not capitalized. So take that for what you want. But anyway, a mechanism called Exploding Eights is used. This means that for each dice result of eight in this roll, an automatic success is achieved and another bonus die can be rolled to see if a further success is achieved. It is possible to keep rolling eights and to keep getting bonus dice. The rules will state if exploding eight mechanic applies to any other role. So the reason why that's one of my favorites is, and it's kind of in tandem with what Jeremy was talking about with Mordheim, is that it creates these really epic story moments in the game where stuff that you just don't believe can happen will happen. And I think depending on your opponent, you can create these situations that might normally feel bad in other hyper competitive games that just feel really good. And it's one of those moments where every time you go to a table and talk about a game that you recently have, it's always going to be one of those exploding eights moments. Case in point, Orgod and I did a campaign that I think he's going to be trying to do a long form write up here pretty shortly, if not a battle report for his channel, right, Jer?
It will be on the channel, I think, but I have to figure out how to get the photos from my phone to my computer now.
For sure. But anyway, so I was playing Veerman. He was playing Mercs. He had, what was the name of the model? It was like an ogre mercenary.
I had an ogre mercenary. Ooh,
yeah, the guy with the shroud over his face. But I had I had a squad of four Veermen, and their names were Scritch, Scratch, Hatch, and Bash. And they went down this hallway on the northern side of the map. I popped a couple of smoke grenades so that way they can make it down the hallway without getting shot to pieces. And then Bash made it out of the hallway, saw this ogre with this big old like two-handed chain gun in his hands, hopped over a barrier, put a shiv to the guy's throat, incorporating it so deep into his anatomy that every drop of blood this creature had in his body spilled to the floor. And the whole reason why was because, you know, my little guy running into this cube just rolled eight after eight after eight. And it's something that I just started calling the freight train, because when you ride the freight train, it just can't be stopped. And
we call it train.
The eight train, the freight train. But it was just one of those moments where I think I've had it occur on two separate occasions where I had a much smaller melee combatant type opponent, or, you know, something that just wasn't made to beat anything, at least not without a lot of help, go in and get work done because of these exploding eights. And it creates these really cinematic moments where, you know, you go for the Hail Mary, and sometimes the random number generator gods smile upon thee, and good work happens. So exploding eights, exploding dice in general is one of my favorite rules, especially my relationship with it as far as Dead Zone is concerned.
Nice. Yeah, so funny story. I just had the same thing happen to me on Saturday where not my ogre, this time it was my alpha simian. I left him out in the open basically because I wasn't worried about him being shot by a GCPS gunner. And that GCPS gunner managed to roll like 5 8s plus like two other hits on top of that. So he had like 7 hits.
That's rough.
And so after all my saves, I had like one wound left, but it was a grenade launcher, so it was a blast weapon, and he blasted me into the wall, and then the wall damage rolled like 4 8s, killing him. So I lost my Alpha Simian before he ever even got to combat.
Dude, and sometimes it creates those feel bad type moments, but you know that it eventually works your way, and you get to ride the eight train too.
The biggest difference, I think, because I play a lot of games that have similar mechanics that with the ability to have a dice that then gives you an additional die roll.
Mm-hmm.
But Dead Zone is the only one where usually that I played, and maybe I'm misremembering, maybe there's another one out there that I played that I'm just not remembering right, but it's Dead Zone is the only one that where one or the Mantic series of games where you roll your exploding die, it gives you another exploding die. Most of them, once you get that first explode, the next one doesn't. It just ends to not have as much skew, I would guess.
I think Extreme Colossal Wrestling had it, but I'll need to check on that.
It could have, but I do remember quite a few other games that had the exploding ability, but most of them do end right after their first explode. And it's written well into the rules of like, once this dice explodes, the next one can't.
Mm-hmm.
But...
Savage, have you ever played a game with exploding dice mechanic?
Similar, but kind of like Jeremy said, they had a cap on it. I remember I was uncanny for this, and I would piss off people in 40K. Some of the Eldar weapons had some really interesting hijinks, and what the hell was it? Striking Scorpions, their Exarch had an option, I think it was the Biting Blade, and you could continually, like every time you rolled a six or something on your hits, you could get another hit and another hit, and it would end at a certain point. It can only stack so far, but you could end up with this ridiculous number of hits in melee combat just from one guy. So I was going to say, the first thing that comes to mind, you know, what you really do with the eight train is it's overkill. That's your extremely flamboyant death.
Yeah.
I remember watching Critical Role, and if you're not familiar, that's the Vox Machina. It's the live original actual game of D&D that Vox mm-hmm. Machina came from. And I think I was watching, I don't remember the campaign, I don't remember whatever, but it was Percy, the guy who makes the guns, and he pulled out his rifle called Bad News, and he just took like one shot, and he like rolls X number of dice, and he's literally like, okay, so that does 70 damage. And rough. And the DM is sitting there like, oh God, that's okay. So you, and then he goes, no, wait, sorry, modifiers. And then he adds and ends up doing like 100 something damage altogether. And the DM is just sitting there as he's listening to all this get added up. The crowd is just cheering them on, and he's just like, holy shit.
And there's my big bad evil guy.
Yeah, exactly. So. Anyway, that's kind of my experience there. I've not played one that had sort of an infinite exploding eights mechanic. No.
Mm. Yeah, that, like I said, it really just comes down to what I like about it is it gives you the opportunity to make that Hail Mary that that some other games just don't offer you. And then when it pulls off, you're like, man, am I glad that I took that risk? You know, the risk favors the bold. So,
yeah,
that's one of my favorites. What's your first favorite game mechanic, Brisky?
I'm going to go with pins and order tests from Beyond the Gates of Antares. Now, without getting too digressed onto, you know, the mechanics and all the other stuff, this is basically bolt action in space. It was a game made by Rick Priestley and another gentleman whose name escapes me right now, Bennett something, with Warlord Games. And they recently took this, Warlord no longer supports it or pushes it or whatever. It's kind of an indie game. It's miniatures agnostic, all that stuff. But it basically uses order dice. You're controlling units, and you can tell them to do any number of things with command dice. I could get into their whole... random order by turn. You literally have the number of dice for the number of units you has and all that. That's really cool. I like that instead of a you go, I go. But the thing that always irked me playing battle games like Warhammer was you had no representation of attrition in the game.
Okay.
You could have a unit take half casualties and they're still like, yep, half our guys died. We'll just carry on as usual. Yep, the vehicle's halfway blown up. It's going to keep rolling forward and doing what it can. Yep, we've lost this and that and the other thing, and we're falling back, but we stopped falling back, and everything's normal now. There just was no real representation that damage or loss affected how the unit operated. That really irked me. And so I started watching bat reps from the Tabletop Warlords. I'll link their channel in the description. They basically just do bat reps and discuss a lot of the lore and their builds and stuff. They're a great channel, but they're centered basically around this game. And you have a mechanic called order tests, and you have what are called pin markers. And the short version is anytime your units get shot at or take damage, they pick up a number of pin markers, which stack. Again, it can be for different things. They, you know, they lose a close combat. They get so many casualties from shooting. They get shot at. even those will rack up pins. And then, so anytime you want your unit to do something, you have to take into account the number of pins it has and actually do an order test. Now, some of the basic orders are, you know, these are pretty straightforward, like fire, shoot without moving, advance, move and shoot, run, move quickly without shooting, ambush, wait for a chance to react. Rally is a specific one to lose pin markers. In other words, you actually have to tell your unit to do nothing but get their shit together to not have these, because there's a chance. The thing is, with so many pin markers, it's a modifier to your test to just follow an order. In other words, how this relates, how this would relate if you were just looking at the real life example. Okay, fine. You have squad A that lost three of its guys, and now you're ordering them to run out into a courtyard and shoot at target B. And squad A takes stock of the situation, goes, we just lost three guys. They take a command test for this. They very well could sit there and go, you know what? That doesn't sound like a good move. So no matter in your head that you've planned out that they're going to run and shoot this other unit, they might go, sorry, no can do, Bossarino. So basically, you have the fact that it can stack up pins. You have an order to remove pins. You basically just have a representation here that, yes, you have a unit on the battlefield. Yes, it's taking some damage. They are not all going to follow your orders, do everything. It's something that creates a very realistic feel to a battle situation that I don't see in many other games. You used to have, I used to like 40K's version of pinning, and the fact that you could have a unit that was just kind of stuck where it was and couldn't do much, that they would automatically fall back and keep falling back until they were off the table, that kind of thing. But it just, it wasn't really real. You had to really break that unit. You had to do severe damage to that unit, and then that was it. It wasn't, you know, you could have a unit get shot at and take a pin and fail a test just because nobody wants to poke their head out. And that was more real to me, and that made more sense than anything else. So, go ahead.
I'm sorry, go ahead. Go ahead.
It just made it more real. You know, you actually have a situation where you only have the number of turns. You can only activate your unit one time, and there's a chance if it's heavily pinned, it's not going to do anything. And that was a very real mechanic. That was something that added a lot of depth to the game and made a lot of sense, and made a lot of sense of how you would prioritize things. Like, okay, cool, that unit has five pins. He's either going to have to rally it and get those off. I'm not going to worry about that big gun because he's not likely to be able to shoot it. I'm going to move on to something else. I'm going to take the objective, or I'm going to do that to another unit. Like, it adds a whole layer of tactical depth. So anyway, you were saying?
Yeah, I was going to say, I played a couple of games of
Bolt Action.
Yeah, Bolt Action, when I was over in doing Wargamer Girls Valhalla. And I remember that kind of. So it creates a couple of different things. You sit there, and as the player who owns the pinned unit, you're trying to decide what's the order of activation. Because if I don't activate them now, then I could lose them. But if I activate them now and they don't do anything, then I'm giving my opponent the advantage as well.
Yep. That's right. It adds timing. You know, you have to go, okay, cool. Is this unit going to keep taking damage? And if it's your Death Star unit, you know, you're pretty sure that's going to be the case. It's just going to keep taking hits. So you do have to decide, you know, when do you go on the offensive? When do you just get the unit back in the game?
Jeremy, you were going to say something?
Yeah, Star Wars Legion uses a very similar mechanic, except for the droids can't be pinned.
Because, you know, they're imagine, droids.
Yeah, I was going to say, just imagine R2-D2 and C-3PO. Like, they're, like, kind of, like, shimmying through Stormtrooper blaster fire. Oh,
I think,
goodness me.
I believe they get the pinning markers still, but they don't, because it takes just more of them to break them. But they don't get, they don't have to take the pinning test like everybody else.
Right.
And then they don't actually benefit from cover either, when they have a pin marker, because when you get pinned in Star Wars Legion, you automatically get the benefit of light cover, because it's representing that you're now, like, on the ground trying to
find the ground.
Yeah, you're trying to find that micro train to hide behind.
There's some grains of sand that'll save my life.
I hate sand.
It's coarse and gritty and gets everywhere.
It gets everywhere.
But beyond that's the only other game I can personally think of that has some similar rules that are outside of the Warlord family. Obviously, the Warlord game systems uses the pinning, including Warlords of Erewhon, which is their fantasy game. Mm-hmm. And that's a real different way to see a fantasy game work, where like usually in fantasy it's all about the attrition of your big squads through your outnumbering them. So basically I crush you through my sheer weight. But Warlords of Erewhon does basically, it's just a fantasy version of
Beyond the Gates of Antares.
Well, right. No, because it's not the Beyond the Gates of Antares is D10.
Yeah.
Bolt Action and Warlords and Conflict 47 are all still D6 systems.
Yep. Very true.
So that's the hugest difference between those three and Gates of Antares is what dice they use as your primary dice.
Yep.
Does Rogue Stars kind of has like pinning and fatigue dice, right? Markers that affect whether or not you get to activate.
Yes, there is a fatigue mechanic in Rogue Stars. It doesn't work exactly the same. Plus, each guy is kind of his own individual guy.
Right. Jeremy, what was your second rule?
My second rule is the Warcry fighter ability cards. And what the fighter ability cards do in Warcry that I thought was really cool is, let's say I get this certain character kind of in a bad position and he might be surrounded and I think he's going to die next turn. Well, if I roll well enough on my little column command dice, but they're basically, what was the actual name? I don't remember if Games Workshop likes to give names of things that don't make sense, right?
Yeah, and then like a similar rule in a different game or for a different faction has a different name, but the same rule.
Yeah, but so they had you have five dice that you roll at the beginning of your turn, and then you separate your dice in between doubles, triples, and quadruples. And then if you have it, unfortunately, all your single dice go away. And then you can spend those doubles, triples, or quadruples on these special abilities. And each faction has their own special abilities, and then there's the generic special abilities as well. And so depending on, and then again it becomes like, well, do I want to spend this triple that I and you don't have to, let's say I roll four threes, I don't have to spend them as the four. I can choose to spend three of those to do a triple instead of using it as a quad. Does that make sense? Do I spend this triple right now to do like Whirlwind of Death, or do I hold on to this quad because my Ogre Breacher's not quite where he needs to be and I can give him a triple later to get that living battering ram, which lets me like basically do another move action and fight everybody within range. So that was a great ability rule set to me, because it made every faction have like its own unique abilities that it could do that gave it its own type of flavor outside of the let's roll sixes and hit each other, or let's roll two dice and if I roll higher than you automatically lose kind of set. I also really like the fact that Warcry didn't have any defensive rolls. So it is super fast. It's just I roll, and if I beat your toughness, you get wounded. There's no armor saves or anything like that. So games go really fast, and you can play. I've been able to play three games in a 30-minute period in Warcry.
That's a lot of games.
Uh-huh. I've had one game end on the first turn.
Oh, that's not a good quality game.
Raffle stomp.
Actually, nobody even died. The mission was to run the objective off the board edge. He picks a model that can, that's the messenger. I pick the board edge. I tell him at the beginning of the first turn what board edge is the board edge to be off of. And they move their messenger off. Well, he was playing the Untamed Beast, which has a little dog, which had a speed of 7. So if you double moved him, it's speed 14. Your board is only like from the middle of the board is only like 8 inches wide by 13 inches long or something like that. So yeah, he was just able to move the dog right off the board on the first turn.
Rough.
Way to go, Lassie.
I guess it's really a cat. It's like a saber-toothed cat, but we call it a dog.
It's got four legs and can run the ball. I'm going to call it what I want.
So, yeah, was it one of those griff hounds?
No, it's a the Untamed Beast. They have they're all chaos. It was a, so the game was originally released with the Untamed Beast and the Iron Golems as the two starting factions. So when I was teaching everybody, that's who the only two we had available.
Okay.
It wasn't until like a week later I was able to pick up the next faction, which was the Zinchi inspired faction, which I can't remember the name of off the top of my head. The Eyes of Nine, maybe? No, that's actual Zinchi faction. There's so many factions in Warhammer. I'm sorry, guys.
Don't worry about it.
But
it's hard to keep up.
We're just talking about the awesome parts here. You gotta go.
The Cypher
man.
Lords. That's their name. I remembered the Cypher Lords. And so all my teaching games that I taught were with the Iron Golems and the Untamed Beast. And the Untamed Beast are super fast, where the Iron Golems are super hitty. And so they're kind of like a mirror match. If you did Necromunda when it first came out, it's like having the Eshers versus the Goliaths, same kind of scenario.
That was rough. I remember wanting to play the Eshers so bad, but anyone who chose the Goliaths just friggin' stomped me every time.
Correct.
Yeah, pretty much.
Not anymore. The Eshers are have way better stuff now. Sorry, stretching.
It's that time of day, huh? Brisky, do you want me to go next, or do you want to go next?
As a matter of fact, I want you to go next, Patty.
Well, I appreciate your invitation, because
I want you to go first before a tree falls over or the power goes out or something.
Oh yeah, right now there's a crazy storm going on, so I have to get all my peace out before I lose power, since
keep your peace in. We know it's not that kind of show.
Well, I mean, it's audio only, so if it's like hit them hard and I can get real close to the mic. But anyway, no, it's so my next one is Focus and Fury from War Machine and Hordes, now commonly known as War Machine, because they dropped Hordes as the name, so it's no longer War Hordes, it's War Machine.
It's forever will be War Hordes.
Right. Forever War Hordes in my heart. And that's actually an apt statement, because I'm going to be reading Focus from the Mark III War Machine rules. Mostly because I'm familiar with these rules. I haven't played a game of Mark IV, so it didn't feel sincere enough in order to be reading from the Mark IV rule set. But largely, Focus and Fury have remained the same. So right. Keep that in mind as we move forward. So out of the Mark III first, well, is that weird? Mark III first edition? So this is the Mark III book that came out before any errata, blah, blah, blah. And it's actually really cool, because Jeremy made sure that I got this book all signed from the developers, artists, and people at Privateer Press. So again, thank you very much for that. This is a prized book for me that I will retain in my collection for forever.
Paper.
Anyway,
I don't remember how I pulled that off, but I did. But I remember doing it.
Page 83 out of the Mark III book. It says, focus manipulation. This model has a focused stat. During your control phase, this model replenishes its focus points so that it has a number of equal to its focus. To replenish focus, a model gains focus points so that it has a number equal to its current focus. This model begins the game with the number of focus points equal, blah, 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 blah. Basically, each of your king pieces, if you're not familiar with War Machine, each of your king pieces has a focus or a fury stat, perhaps an arcane stat, depending. And that stat is used in a number of different ways. First off, you have like your knights, bishops, and rooks models in the form of war beasts or war jacks that can use that, what do you call that? Economy? Special stat? What's the word I'm looking for?
It's not affinity, is it?
No, not affinity. I'm looking for like action economy, but not quite. Anyway, the point being is that resource. There, geez, what an easy word. Resource. So it's a resource that you can use across the board to get yourself action economy, increased chances. I wouldn't necessarily say increased luck or game defining spells, if that's the case, for depending on which king piece you chose. So in War Machine, you have a warcaster or a warlock that has a rack of spells that include damage spells, buff spells, debuff spells, and the like. And they come with a cadre of war beasts or war jacks. And your warlock or your warcaster can assign part of their focus resource in order to make sure that their war jacks or war beasts are doing work on each turn. A focus point can be spent to add dice to rolls, which is a nice rule for me, because I kind of like how the dice math kind of skews when you're able to add or subtract dice from somebody's roll. It makes it feel like you can invest into certain actions and help make those actions actually happen, instead of, you know, you're banking this whole game off of one dice roll and there's nothing you can do about it. At the very least, you can give a die to an attack roll or something to make sure that something happens. Other than that, there's other spells that you can use. So what it really boils down to is kind of what I said at the beginning of the episode, is using this resource in order to manipulate the chances of something happening. It kind of skews the things in your favor so long as you wisely spend it.
Right. And obviously, you know, getting more specific, we're talking about like, okay, you have a super gun on one of your war jacks that absolutely must hit. Will you boost the hit roll? Okay, cool. This thing is super tough. I'm not so worried about hitting it, but I might not actually do damage. Boost the damage roll. You know, it's selective is the thing that most stood out to me about it anyway.
Yeah, it's flexible. Plus, Jeremy, what did you think of focus? You spent a lot of time playing War Machine, right?
Yeah. I always thought focus was maybe a little underpowered for what you got out of it until maybe third edition came in, where you got the free focus on each of your warjacks, because your action economy with focus was, if I brought a lot of warjacks, I couldn't power all of them up because I was limited. Nobody had, what, 7 is the highest focus caster?
Is it not 8 with Avatar of Menoth or the Harbinger of Menoth?
She might have 8, right? I can't remember.
Oof, good one to look up. Keep talking, I'll look it up.
So 7, but 7's still on the high end. Most warcasters were 6, and some of them were limited all the way down to 5.
Or so 4.
Yeah, I don't think any of them were 4.
Karchev, I think, was 4.
No, he's 5. Definitely 5. Okay,
anyway.
So with that, with me, I if I was going to play on a war machine army, I wanted to have a lot of war machines. So playing a bunch of war machines, I wanted a bunch of focus to be able to power my war machines. But I never seemed to have enough and be able to use my spells at the same time. Right? Because that's one of your biggest problems.
Yeah, focus really became a worthwhile mechanic, especially like mid Mark 3. But for the record, Harbinger of Menoth, I'm looking it up on warmachineuniversity.com. I could be wrong. This might be a different version of her, but right now it's showing her as focus 10.
Damn. Karchev has 6. And I want to say that probably Butcher is the least amount of focus in Kador. And he so has
the lowest I think you would find is a six. I remember Thyron was a six for Rhett.
No, it's I know that not Boomhauer, but what's the troll guy that I really like, Jeremy?
Well,
that's different.
Oh, fair enough.
Because that's Fury.
Well, he has five. And I think Madrak even has five. Yeah, Karchev is six.
For the most part, you're going to find six. The Butcher, I think, has five. And then one time he has a star. And it, I mean, it was random. You actually had to, like, roll for his focus. And then one time he has six. Like, he just jumped around. But for the most part, yes, you are going to find in the War Machine, most of them are going to have six, seven is your average, right? Whereas in Warlocks from the Hordes, you would have some fours and fives, Focus and Fury, or Furies, because that was the thing. They tried to balance it because a Warlock could come with nothing but War Beast, and they could boost all those War Beasts up super high and have them come and smash face all day long.
Yeah.
But then they have to be able to leech all that Fury back off those War Beasts. So if I only have four Fury to leech, I can't boost more than maybe two War Beasts fully up.
Right.
Without the fear of them going crazy and not being able to activate them frenzying up the next turn and not being able to activate. And so then I lose a 18 point model for a whole turn that could come back to bite me in the butt, right?
Okay.
And that even brings up the fact that it doesn't just impact your Warjacks and your Warbeasts. This is also a means of keeping your caster alive when you look at the defensive uses of spell armor and all that other stuff. So not only is it for the other units, but it's also him casting spells in general, which can be to buff, debuff, destroy, attack, save, whatever, but even to save his own ass. And in a game where you have mechanics like assassinating being a victory condition, you know, caster kill, well, great, that comes in handy, and you want to have some handy if he's gonna get sniped or, you know, just sacked basically.
Also remember War Machine Warcasters, every focus point that was left on them counted as a point of armor. Whereas a Warlock, they didn't count as armor, but they could cut themselves and transfer, or would damage. Not cut themselves and transfer, but they could transfer that damage off themselves to a War Beast by spending that Fury.
Yep.
So that's another boon. I think I would rather get the transfer ability to transfer damage much more than that one point of armor.
Ooh, you know, I remember one of my favorite was just absorbing, was it three or four damage? Do you guys remember? You can spend focus to absorb damage.
Five. Five for one.
I'd rather absorb the damage than transfer to a War Beast.
Yep. And that's, you got preferences like that because of that very mechanic. You had guys who were like, you know what? Focus is not my thing. Warjacks are not my thing. I'm going to go with Beast and I'm going to go with Warlocks. Same thing.
But it really
reverse.
Allowed you to chain, like, first off, you'd almost kind of build your list around some of the focus and spells that your caster had. But because of your being able to slough off damage to your War Beasts, or being able to just absorb damage through your focus, it allowed you to change what your strategy was mid-game.
Oh, yeah.
But, so that's that was my second favorite mechanic.
Nice. I was going to say, yeah, doing all those checklists I did, the army list review videos, that was always the thing. It's like your army is dependent on the caster and on the warlock, really, for what you're going to do with it. The choices were secondary to what the caster could bring to the table. So. Yeah.
And then what was your other rule, Brewski?
I was going to go, this is going to sound kind of dumb, but I was going to go over the gator mechanic in Battletech. And the reason I chose that one is it simplifies an otherwise very complicated series of mechanics. Short version, what gator is you're dealing with the mechanics of modifiers and shooting. in a game that basically is all shooting. And it really gives you the tactical depth of movement and speed and distance and all that other stuff. And it just makes the whole thing easy to do. I compare this somewhat to the stack in Magic the Gathering, but with shooting for this. Now, they call it Gator because it literally, it's an acronym. So let's say you want to shoot a target in Battletech. And I'm just talking normal Battletech here. So G-A-T-O-R. G is for gunnery skill. So the first thing is what is your pilot's gunnery skill? It's usually, I think, 4. If you have a better skill, it's a, what is it, -1, 3? I forget if it adds or subtracts, but that can go up or down.
So the lower your gunnery skill, the lower number you need to hit your target.
Yep. So lower is better.
You think of it, at average die roll, you're trying to roll a 7 to hit. At gunnery skill 4. So gunnery skill 3 would need to roll a 6. Gunnery skill 2 would need to roll a 5. Gunnery skill 1 would need a 4.
Gunnery skill 1 is just so broken, like this person literally can't miss.
You can actually get gunnery skills. You can get gunnery skill 0 if you're doing a campaign.
Oh yeah, I know.
Oh wow.
Yeah. So that's just the first part of the modifier. So that's the first thing you take into account. And literally you're just adding these numbers up. That's why I say it's really, the thing is it simplifies what is otherwise a complicated process. So G is your gunnery skill. A is attacker movement. And this, the attack and the target movement are two different things. Sometimes this would get confusing starting out, I remember, but it really is simple when you get to it. Attacker movement is just what kind of movement did the shooter do? Did you walk? Did you run? Which basically means you were moving faster and further. Did you use jump jets? You know, you're literally flying somewhat. These all add to the modifier. Okay. T is for target movement. And that is more how far. It's not which way did you go. It's how far did the other mech move. If you have a heavy or an assault mech and it only moved 2 or 3 spaces, it's going to add a low number to the modifier. The reason that light mechs can be really hard to hit is because they can literally speed like 12 spaces and double your modifier pretty much.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So like if you only move and it's just by hex count, that's why I say the attacker and target is a little different. So, you know, simple, I literally just did like a simple example. There's actually a calculator for this online, but like, okay, let's say you have a normal gunnery skill of 4. You walked. So your attacker movement modifier is 1. So now you're up to 5. Target movement, I forget how many hexes I put in for this, but it's pretty much booking it. Let's say 3. So at this point, you need 8 or better just to hit the guy based on those 3 factors alone. And there's still 2 more to go.
It's for every 3 hexes you move, it's +1 to your TMM.
Right. So there you go. Now, then other just takes into account stuff like terrain. Do you have hills in the way or trees in the way? Are you in those trees? Is the other guy in those trees? It just accounts for any and all modifiers related to terrain or any other factors involved. So that you've taken into account the pilot skill, the movement of the target, the movement of the attacker, and terrain, scenery, other modifiers. And then you have range. This works very similar to Infinity. You have every weapon has short, medium, and long range.
Okay.
And it just falls into a number of hexes. And it doesn't vary weapon within your technical range. In other words, Inner Sphere is one thing, Clan is another thing. I'm not going there, but the mechanic works the same either way. The range is just, is it short, medium, or long? That adds, I believe, 1, 2, or 3. So you can quickly see that if, you know, this is a game of figuring how much or how little you want to be moving and your chances of actually nailing the other guy when you're shooting him. And if you're paying in points for better gunnery skills, obviously you're going to be putting that on mechs that have the guns you really want to hit or want to do damage. But you can see also how you keep yourself safe and how you keep yourself out of trouble. Like, okay, I really need to take advantage of trees and cover and hills. I need to use speed where I have it. I have a faster mech than my opponent. Good. He's going to be running more of the time than he's going to be, you know, hobbling along, taking shots himself. The whole thing of it, it's not anything special if you really think about it, but it just simplifies what is otherwise a really complicated mechanic.
I like the fact that it uses an easy acronym to remember.
Yeah.
Because I think, you know, there's a couple of games out there. Necromunda. That's got a lot of modifiers that can happen situationally to rolls that make it really hard to, you know, if you don't have like a quick guide super handy, you can be stuck just pouring through a rule book for a little while.
All right. Now we're going to go through the acronym for redundancy. No, I'm kidding.
Right.
But yeah, it was easy enough to do. It's an old mechanic. It's been around forever, and it's fairly easy to pick up. You know, Jeremy has it better because he's done it infinitely more times than I have, but even I just have that basic down that I know roughly what's what without even consulting a chart or looking at something. It's like it's easy enough to grasp once you get the hang of it.
Funny enough, I learned it without the acronym. But the acronym would definitely help.
Oh.
The
person who taught me did not teach me the acronym.
I was going to say, everyone has to teach you how to play a game because Jeremy doesn't read rules.
Well, if you watch my YouTube video from today, you'll see why I don't read rules. That's a lot of books to read, and that's just Warhammer 40K books.
Oh, yeah.
Jeremy was asking us all in private chat at one point which book he should go over and showed us the stack. And it was literally, I didn't count, but it looks like 40 or 50 books. I told him to roll percentile.
I don't think that's even a tenth of his books. It's his 40K books.
It's about 40% of my books.
Yeah. But even so, I told him to roll percentile just to figure it out. So. Alrighty then.
Jeremy, did you have another rule? I think we've got like 28 minutes or so.
So I did want to talk about another one, but I think I'm going to pass because I think it'll take up the full 28 minutes. I wanted to talk about the campaign system for Path to Glories for Age of Sigmar.
Ooh, so, yes.
But instead, I think I'm going to talk about the Rampant rule series and how the dice rolling... the opposite of what Bruski said with his point on the first game he talked about,
pinning when
Beyond the Gates
and Terrors
with the pinning and orders. The Rampant series has two basic rules for it. You have to roll two dice and roll above the number to be able to actually activate your unit to get them do what you want to do. For both Lion and Dragon in Xenos, certain units can do certain actions for free because they're better at those. But let's say I have light infantry and I want them to shoot. They might not want to shoot, so I have to roll the two dice to let them shoot, but they can move all day because they want to stay in cover.
Right. Okay.
Which I like that rule. I like the rule a lot more in Dragon and Lion because it really makes you think about what unit, because it is an I go you go game. Well, it is not an I go you go game. My bad. It is I go with all my units until I fail one of my orders, and then you get to go with all your units until you fail one of your orders. So it really makes you think: do I really want to make my knights who charge on a 9 charge right now as my first action? Because if I fail this 9 on 2d6, I lose my whole turn and then all my guys might get countercharged now. So I thought that rule was pretty unique, and it makes you really, really contemplate who you want to activate and in what order you want to activate them. And then to represent, there's no real pinning mechanic. There is a mechanic for taking extra casualties loss as you suffer wounds, morale. But the way it represents its big difference, as you lose combat effectiveness, you roll less dice for your unit. So every unit in Dragon and Lion rolls 12 dice for starts. Doesn't matter how big the unit is. If it's a 12-man unit, it's 12 dice. If it's a 6-man unit, it's 12 dice. If I don't know if there's a way to get a 18-man unit, it doesn't matter. It's 12 dice.
Oh, yeah. I remember that.
So in Xenos, it's 10 and 5. Biggest difference, they just cut it in. Your unit sizes are now 10-man units and 5-man units. And Dragon, it's and Lion, it's 6-man units and 12-man units. They go up by sixes. once you get to half strength, you are now considered a broken unit and you only get to roll half your dice. So in Lion and Dragon, you're rolling 6 dice, and in Xenos, you're rolling 5 dice. And I thought those represented the rules really well to get you a really fast and easy game done really, really in a short amount of time. I think I played a game of Xenos Rampant followed by a game of Dragon Rampant in an hour and a half time period, where you generally can't do that with most of the other game systems out there, unless you're playing a skirmishy type game. So this is a squad-based game where you're running like 4 or 5 squads and the game is getting done that fast, because you're kind of almost using each of these squads as like one individual. So you're playing more of a skirmish game, just represented with larger guys, larger units, I guess. And I really enjoyed that. I thought it was a really great game, really good system. And I love it. I want to feature it on my channel eventually. Just trying to get the right setup for it to go.
Nice.
I really liked the rampant system, because like he was saying, that rolling 12 dice, unless you're at less than half strength, makes it feel a lot better when you kind of when you're on the receiving end of that alpha strike. It still gives you the opportunity to get an alpha strike in. And that means a lot to somebody who doesn't have a lot of time to game, but puts time into the hobby and like putting together these units and painting them and such.
Cool biz. I mean, it sounds that sounds easy enough, but it's a workable mechanic that, again, adds that strategic depth. You know, you have to figure with timing. It has a use it or lose it factor. So,
yes.
Indeed. All right. I am out of mechanics. Patty, do you have another one?
Yeah. So continuing with the theme of like skewing chances or giving the underdog player an opportunity to rise up would be Malifaux. And I know we talked about this a little bit in the past, so I actually downloaded the rules for third edition Malifaux. And this is on page 9. Yeah, if you haven't tried Malifaux, I'd give it a shot. It's definitely one of those games where I wish that it received a lot more love than it gets, because I feel like it deserves a lot more. Kind of like what Jeremy was saying earlier, where it's like, I'm not just rolling 2 dice to see if I roll better than you. And then if I do so, then something happens. It's kind of like that back and forth of just whose luck is better than the other. But with Malifaux, you use a deck of playing cards, full deck to include the jokers. And in the game, when you make an attack, you have your deck of playing cards and then you have your cheat hand. And then depending on which master you bring, your cheat hand can be anywhere between 5, 6, or 7 cards and whatnot. But if you make an attack, you flip the top card off of your deck of playing cards. And if you don't like that card, you have what's called your cheating hand. And so you do your flip. If you don't like it, I'll read the rule. So anyway, here on page 9 of the third edition Malifaux rules, you have cheating fate. Sometimes a flip does not end up quite the way that you'd like. Malifaux gives players the chance to change their destiny by using fate cards from their hand to cheat fate. After flipping a card, a player has the opportunity to cheat fate by replacing the card they flipped into the conflict with a card from their hand. To do this, they choose a card from their hand that they wish to cheat fate with and place it into the conflict, discarding their previous card. Cheating fate does not count as flipping a card, and it cannot be done if the flipped involved one or more fate modifiers. In this case, it's a negative modifier. So if there was something where somebody levied a negative modifier onto your flip, then you'd have to just take whatever the flip was. Thus, it gives the opposing player a chance. Like, if you had some really good cards, you'd at least have to wait in action. So there's this kind of like never-ending tug and war over what tactics the opposing player used versus what you as the opponent have done. And it doesn't make it so that it's terribly unbalanced one way. You know, if they're making that Hail Mary play, so long as they use the tactics and stacked fate modifiers against you in their favor, then they might be rewarded for theirs. But anyway, the option still persists. And what I like about this particular one in comparison to the other mechanics I've talked about throughout the episode is there's a lot of there's a lot of tactics behind it, right? You don't want to use your red Joker, which in the world of Malifaux, red Joker is like your critical. It is the highest card you can play versus the black Joker, which is the lowest card you can play. I mean, we're talking like crit fail for the black Joker and crit success for the red Joker. Anyway, there's a bunch of different tactics that are included. If you get the black Joker in your hand, you know, sometimes you want to hold on to that card because if you hold on to that card, you know, you're not going to flip that on an attack, but it also takes up a vital spot in your already super dry cheat hand. Meanwhile, if you have that red Joker in your hand, you know, whatever you're going to do, so long as your opponent doesn't also have a red Joker, if I remember correctly, because I'm not exactly sure how they take care of ties in the new edition. But anyway, you know, if you have the red Joker in your hand, whatever you want to do can and will happen. Meanwhile, you know, you don't have to, you can keep track of what cards that you've spent versus what cards you've seen to know what cards are in your deck. So you have a general idea of what actions will take place during the course of your turn. And if you're keeping track of that for your opponent as well, then, you know, on top of everything else that you need to keep track of during the game, if you can multitask and juggle those things in your brain, then you can skew that luck. In Malifaux's words, you can skew fate in order to work with you instead of against you.
Now, to some degree, does that mean card counting comes into play?
Absolutely. So the discard pile, you can always see what card is on top. You cannot go through your opponent's discard pile unless you have a rule that says so. And then, of course, if you ever, you know, draw out of your draw pile or your fate deck, then you shuffle your discard pile and create a new fate deck. In the third edition, I don't remember this being something that happens in the second edition. But in the third edition, I remember seeing a call out that said, you can exile, kind of like think Magic the Gathering, if you're familiar.
Yep.
But you can exile fate cards. I'm not exactly sure how that works or what characters have that mechanic, but it's kind of another interesting thing where I imagine it's if it's you see that card getting played or if you see that on top of a fate deck that you can exile that card. I'm curious how that interacts with like the black or the red Joker, because I mean, for sure, I would exile my black Joker so that way it would never be used against me.
Unless it's like you're an opponent mechanic, kind of like, again, going back to Magic, like Dimir in Ravnica.
Yeah.
That thing just won by eating your opponent's graveyard. Like, oh, hi, I did damage, discard 5 cards. Okay.
Yep.
Great. I attacked you with the next thing and I poured 10 mana into it. Good. You're discarding 10 cards and there goes their deck, you know?
So, yeah, I mean, the theme of my rules today have been, you know, using established rules in order to kind of make your rolls or your random number generator kind of fit towards your tactics or even, you know, those end all be all plays that you're going to make before the game comes to its inevitable end. Those type of things, those moments are my favorite, and the games that facilitate those types of moments really get me going.
Nice. All right.
I mean, if you guys want to, we still have like 10 minutes. Do you want to do a really quick rules that break a game, your least favorite mechanics and your favorite games?
Because
I'll tell you mine. Mine is going back to Hordes and War Machine. It is Frenzying War Beasts.
Really?
Yeah, a few things feel as bad as when you lose the activation for one of your most expensive units in a game.
I mean, it's a risk reward scenario. If you risked it, then you need to you know,
do you need to pay the price?
Yeah, if you didn't get the reward out of it, you gotta pay the price. Sorry. Yeah. I love that mechanic, actually. And you know what mechanic I actually missed from that War Machine and Hordes?
What's that?
Terror and what was before Terror? It wasn't Frenzy. It was
Abomination.
Abomination. Yeah. I miss Terror and Abomination rules. I love rules that make you have to think about, do I want to go in and fight that unit because I might lose the activation of being able to fight against them. There was rules like that. We used to have rules like that in 40K. They've gone away. Any game that I can think of that had rules like that, they've gone away because people are like, oh, well, I don't want to risk not getting to activate my model because that guy's scary. Well, you know what? Going and fighting a goddamn dragon is scary. Excuse my language. You shouldn't. You should have to maybe risk something to go fight that dragon.
I think it really comes down to like feel bad moments is I think a lot of what I've talked about in this episode is last thing you want to do is spend a couple hours putting together this unit, painting the unit, and maybe you can only get one game in a month, if that. And then you go and put this unit down on the table, like, yeah, I can't wait to fight with this unit. And if they don't have Fearless, then they go up and they're like, and they're totally worthless because their command skill is so low, or maybe.
Well, I mean, that's just some of the nature of the game. My first game, War Machine up here, I took an army that was a bunch of croaks that were throwing fireballs. And I right. And I played against an army that was immune to all elemental damage. So I could not do damage to his army. I literally had no chance. Could not hit him with anything.
Yep.
And so at that point, I was like, well, cool. You won this time. Let me do my sideboard army, which is all the gators with the big mouths that will now chomp you to death.
Uh-huh.
And then I pulled out a draw on that one. You know, yeah, sometimes people only get to get in one game. And so maybe know what you're going to play and make sure that you're not just going up against some rando that's going to win at all costs.
Raffles,
right?
Yeah, go out of their way.
But if you're there to game all night, yeah, use it as a learning experience. Sometimes the risk is better than the reward. Sometimes the reward is better than the risk. That's just a part of the game. And that,
I think I kind of agree with that.
I miss having a lot of those games where I actually had the fear of doing something because if I didn't pull it off, I could lose. Or if I did pull it off, then I would win.
Right. Again, shameless self-promotion. I did put a mechanic in Mutants because I did kind of miss that. But there is a mutation where you have like frightful presence and you have to make a save in order to even engage in melee combat with that guy.
Yep.
I do remember you putting that rule in there. Yes.
I remember this as well.
Thank you.
So I can't personally think of a single rule that I would want removed from any one individual game. I can think of a lot of rules that I want back in games that have been taken out.
I mean, I can only give you an example, and I've told you guys this story. I think I did this on a previous podcast, but I'm just going to lump it. I'm sure there are others like it out there in many, many games, but I'm just going to term it and dub it here as faction dick rule. Okay.
What is faction dick rule? I don't think I remember this.
Well, I'm just coming up with a name now, but you guys remember the story I told you about back in third ed 40K, I played Dark Angels and I had a buddy who would play Cypher and run him at the back of his board, basically.
Okay.
If you don't remember, okay, and if you're listening and you have no idea what I'm talking about, way, 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 way back in the day in third ed of 40K, okay. The Dark Angels, as we all know, have to hunt down fallen Dark Angels. These are Dark Angels that turn to Chaos in the Heresy, or turned against the Lion, at least. And Chaos flung them through space and time, and they show up here and there in the 41st millennium to cause trouble, and the Dark Angels do not want their secret of disloyalty, red is loyalty, getting out. Okay, so in third ed, this actually had rules. This actually had a rule represented in the game. No matter what mission you were playing, if you were playing Dark Angels, you had a rule that at the start of a game, you would roll a D6, and on a 6, somebody in the other army, and it had to be something as little as a sergeant, it could be a character, whatever, but some model was a fallen or had information about the fallen, and you had to kill that thing in close combat, which basically would be you capture it essentially and take it back to the rock to interrogate it, and that would get you victory points. Or if this didn't happen, would lose you victory points. And if you were playing something that didn't use points, it would be like a moral loss or a moral win, depending on what you did. Now, okay. That's that. Now, Cypher is the Mac Daddy of Fallen Angels. So if he's on the board, you have to get him. And he was a multiplier of victory points either way, and a major loss or major win. And I had a buddy who would play Chaos and took Cypher, and would sit his ass at the very back of the table and make me wade through his entire goddamn army to get at him.
So was there a point deficit if you didn't get Cypher?
Yeah.
Like, what I'm saying is, would they earn points from not letting you get Cypher?
Yes.
Crap.
Now you understand how I came up with that name, huh?
Oh, yeah. No, that's a faction dick rule.
Faction FDR is not an Franklin Delano Roosevelt. It is faction dick rule, ladies and gentlemen.
I really like that. You have no idea how much my political soul appreciates you calling it an FDR.
Patent freaking pending.
I'm going to internalize that.
Third edition Warhammer 40K had a lot of cool, crazy rules like that could cause the game to totally bend and break. Also, is when the first time they ever introduced the ability to be able to field a named character without your opponent's permission.
And I really do like those super off the wall, very specific rules. My only problem with those is, as somebody who likes to play narrative games, but also likes to play really tight rules games, you know, like rules where there's not a whole lot of, I'll bring up Giant Slayer Games. Congrats, Giant Slayer Games. Hopefully we're going to be live on Monday. But anyway, I brought up the point where it's like, I like to play tight rules where there's little reference to the rule books, you know, the least amount of time that you have to spend in the book and the more time you get to spend playing the game, the better the game is. But I also really like those really weird, very specific interactions between models, because I think that really brings a lot of the lore to life in the game.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, I can see that.
And then speaking of Giant Slayer Games, because I always put out kind of what our topic is for the episode into my Twitter machine, and Giant Slayer Games, who, if you're not familiar with, he's one of those accounts that's going on there. He's totally free speech. He's going to make a website where if you want to publish games, you can do so. Check him out. Giant Slayer RPGs on Twitter. I put the question out. I said, what mechanics, blah, 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 blah. He said, I don't know if I have a favorite mechanic, but I've gotten to appreciate simpler rules light systems. I like the flexibility it gives me both as a player and as a dungeon master. I said, duly noted, I like games that don't require collegiate level engineering to understand. Kind of going back to my point of, I don't want to have to reference the rules book every 5 seconds. And then he said, but I do enjoy some crunchy games from time to time as well. And I very much agree with that statement. Every once in a while, like War Machine Mark II with head, you know, like the throw rules, the head grapple, the arm grapple rules, those crunchy rules. I've heard Infinity was super crunchy. Is it still super crunchy, Bruce?
Infinity is super crunchy still, but it has a lighter rule set called
Code One.
Which Code One doesn't give you quite as many rules, a lot less interactions, but it's still the core rules are the same.
Mm. Yep. And then he continues on. He says, as far as system goes, he's pretty enamored with Basic Fantasy RPG. It's essentially a modified Basic Expert clone. It's simple, easy to customize. It's an ongoing, essentially open source project started by Chris Gonerman. The PDFs are free and the books are sold at cost. So that's another one of the things that I kind of want to bring up just at the tail end of this episode is some of us are better at making games than others. if you have an idea, and I say this almost every episode, put it out there. Let us hear about it. If you don't feel like you deserve money from it, put it out as a free copy, as a pay what you want even. Giant Slayer Games is there for you to help publish your ideas. And if anything, if you make even one person's tabletop time better, you're better for it. So there's my high horse. There's my soapbox. Thank you, Giant Slayer Games.
Get back to your hobby and your community. They'll thank you for it, give you a lot of likes on Instagram and Facebook and Twitter, and you'll feel better every day.
So thank you for offering me the opportunity to share Giant Slayer's opinion on the show, Savage Brewski.
We like opinion. I tweeted about this because I don't think we get enough feedback. I think we're like, we'll put ourselves out there and be like, hey, what do you guys want to hear about? What do you want to ask us? What do you want to know? Would you like to know more? You know, we do all this stuff and sometimes we don't hear back. So we do like to hear from you people. So please comment, like, tweet us. We're on various socials. You've seen them. I've put them out there. So please, we like being a two-way street.
Oh, for sure. And I think we should totally try to get JP Got Rockets, because Thursday is a day that I think he stays up pretty late to do his Twitch stream.
I don't know about late. I usually catch him around 4 or 5 our time.
I think it's late for him, depending on his time zone. But
yeah. He is 2 hours ahead of us.
There we go.
Is there anything else we wanted to talk about before we wrap up this episode?
I'm good.
Not really much in the Kickstarter front that I haven't already mentioned. There's really only one newish Kickstarter that I've seen, and actually I think I might have just overlooked it in the past. It's only got about 12 days left. It's called Battle of Valeran, Valerna, and it's a STL files for a fantasy type game, but it has a lot of big large dragons in it. They look kind of cool. So since it's STLs, I am assuming this is going to 100% deliver. It's well over, sure. It's well over its funding goal. $4,000. It's made a little over 30,000. Other than that, I haven't seen really anything new on the Kickstarter or other platforms like that I've super caught my eye.
Okay.
All right.
I know for me, Vengers, Under the Fuchsia Sky Kickstarter, fully funded. So if you did that, you're going to get your rewards. I'm super excited to see what comes of that. I know one of the things that I push on Twitter a lot is Titancraft minis. If you look up them, Titancraft, they're having a poll going on right now for what features that you are, I should say a survey, because you have to go through one of their Google surveys for functions that you can find in the Titancraft STL editor / hero mini and monster mini maker. You should check those guys out. Again, I totally prefer them over Hero Forge any day, not a sponsor. And then, like I said earlier, just a couple seconds ago, Giant Slayer Games, Giant Slayer RPGs. As far as I know, the website should be up on Monday. And if you've ever wanted to self-publish a scenario, a tabletop war game or role-playing game, you should find them and try to publish through them, because they have a lot of following. He works every day to try to show off the creators that he really likes. And he's constantly doing giveaways. If even at the very minimum, if you just need some minis that you need to do, look up Giant Slayer right now. I think he's doing a Cyclops miniature giveaway. If you follow D&D at D&D Bones, if they get to 400 or 500 followers by Monday, he's going to give one lucky winner a Cyclops miniature.
Cool. And very handy.
But anyway,
I think that about wraps us up then.
Pretty concise episode compared to what we've done in the past.
Indeed. We kept this just under an hour and a half, I think. So
if you like the long episodes, let us know. If you like the shorter episodes, also let us know. If you think that maybe we should do funnier voices more often, then let us know.
If you want me to talk like Cleveland, oh, hey, let me know.
So, other words, I hope that everyone's having a great gaming week. We hope to see you all next week. Please share with your friends, like, comment, blah, 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 blah. We'll be hanging out in the section below to talk to you there.
As always, stay savage. Thanks for joining us once again, and we'll see you on the next one.
Bye.
Later, everyone.